All for this another webinar series of Rajanai Care and RIOS, that is the Rajanai Ophthalmic Education Series. This is the 13th webinar we are having during the lockdown here. And as I told you, this webinar is going to be on lasers and retina, but we have had different webinars on different subspecialties in ophthalmology, starting from pediatric ophthalmology, glaucoma, oculoplasty, retina, cataract, and all cornea, and all specialties we have covered. And each of these webinars have been very useful to the practicing ophthalmologists as well as for the residents in particular. And it's been a very popular series as far as the lockdown lectures are concerned. Today we have a very important topic, and the topic is lasers and retina. As you all know, the lasers is the gold standard as far as the retina problem is concerned. And to discuss this topic in depth, we have none other than Dr. Nicey Thomas, who is a retina consultant in Rajanai Care Hospital. Dr. Nicey is a vitreoretinal fellow from Shankar Netralaya, and she is a very, very dynamic and vitreoretinal surgeon, and very good in her medical retina as well, very good in lasers. And she's been with us for almost 2 years now, and she's really a wonderful asset to an hospital like Rajanai Care. Along with that, we have a galaxy of panelists as usual, and we have none other than Dr. Rajiv Raman, who doesn't require any introduction. He is an artificial intelligence man of the world. He is an authority on diabetic retinopathy, senior vitreoretinal surgeon from Shankar Netralaya. And Rajiv Raman has literally put India's map on the international scenario as far as diabetic retinopathy and AI is concerned. We also have with us Dr. Sonal. Dr. Sonal, though she looks very young, she's a very senior vitreoretinal surgeon from Mumbai. And she's got her own clinic. It's called Panorama Eye Clinic in Mumbai. And despite the fact that Mumbai and Chennai are overflowing with COVID patients, Sonal has got the time and the inclination to be with us. I owe our gratitude to Dr. Sonal, who's a very, very good friend of ours, and is a very dynamic VR surgeon, specialist in lasers, and that is the reason why we had Dr. Sonal here with us. Along with Dr. Sonal and Dr. Rajiv, we have Dr. Supriya Gautam. She is a senior vitreoretinal surgeon, head of department of VR surgery in Rajanai Care. And she is actually from Bombay, trained with Dr. Natarajan Aditya Jodh, and then subsequently with Narayan Netralaya. And now she has been holding the flag of Rajanai Care VR surgery for the past so many years. It's always a pleasure to have Supriya, who's an excellent speaker, an authority on medical and surgical retina. We also have Dr. Manoj Khatri. And I have the greatest pleasure of introducing Dr. Manoj Khatri here. Manoj Khatri did his DNB with us in Rajanai Care, and subsequently VR fellowship from Shankar Netralaya and also from L.U. Prasad. And Manoj Khatri is a senior vitreoretinal surgeon and has been taking care of the VR department of Rajanai Care for the past almost 10 years now. Along with, he's also having his own practice called iDocs Hospital. Though he's not well today, he's joining us. That is a great virtue we have of Dr. Manoj Khatri, and we are very blessed. Along with these panelists, we also have Dr. Ramya. Dr. Ramya is also a vitreoretinal consultant in Rajan Eye Care, and Ramya is an expert in ROP. And because of the training she has received from Supriya as well, and she takes care of the department of ROP along with Supriya and other people here, Naisi and Manoj as well, and Shiv Kumar, and we got a very, very busy ROP department. The reason why I wanted Ramya here is that how different it is to do lasers, indirect lasers in ROP patients as well. We want to discuss that. So over to Dr. Naisi Thomas. The sequence of this entire webinar will be like this. We have Dr. Naisi Thomas talk for about 30 to 35 minutes. And subsequently, we'll involve the panel discussion, have the panel discussion. And then we'll take the questions from the audience, from the participants. So over to Dr. Naisi.
Thank you, sir. Is the screen visible?
Yeah, it is visible.
Okay, sir. So good evening, everybody. Today, I'll be talking about lasers and their use in various retinal conditions. So as we all know, LASER is the acronym for light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. And just for the benefit of the PGs, I'll just be talking a little bit about the basics of LASER. So to understand what stimulated emission means, we need to know what the various LASER components are. So LASER basically has three main components, which is the pumping system, the optical cavity, and the lasing medium. Now the pumping system, what it does is it provides energy to the atoms of the lasing medium, which excites the electrons from a lower energy state to a higher energy state. So the energy source of the pumping system, this can be a flash lamp, it can be a laser, it can be electrical discharge, or it can be chemical reactions. So lasing media, the lasers are basically designated by the type of lasing material employed. And these can be solid state, they can be gas, dye, or semiconductor. So as I was saying, electrons in the lasing media, the atoms are usually in the rested state. And when they are pumped by energy, the electrons basically move to a higher state. Now what happens in laser is, when a photon strikes one of these excited atoms, it de-excites them and another photon is released, which is exactly similar to the triggering photon in frequency, phase, and direction. So in a lasing medium where you have multiple excited atoms, this process continues. So these photons will trigger the release of other photons, and this process keeps going as other atoms are getting de-excited. So this finally results in amplification of the number of photons, and this will result in the production of laser. Another important part of the laser is the mirrors which are present on either side of the optical cavity. Now the mirror on one side will be 100% reflective, whereas the mirror on the opposite side will be about 98% reflective. So the reason for that 2% transparency is to allow for the photons to pass through as laser, whereas the remaining will get reflected back to continue the process of stimulated emission. So as we are all aware of, the various laser tissue interactions are photothermal, photochemical, and photoionizing. And recently a newer laser tissue interaction which is being investigated in retinal diseases is photobiomodulation. So photothermal, as we all know, includes photocoagulation. And here there is absorption of light by the target tissue, which results in a temperature rise, which causes denaturation of proteins. So all our argon, krypton, diode, and frequency doubled NDR lasers cause this type of effect. In photoionizing, this is basically what is done in NDR capsulotomy, where there is photo disruption. So high energy light is deposited over a very short interval to the target tissue. So there is stripping of electrons from the molecules of that tissue, which then rapidly expands, causing an acoustic shock wave that disrupts the treated tissue. So in retinal diseases, this is basically used in hyalodotomy using the NDR laser. Now coming to the various retinal lasers which are commonly used today, we have the argon laser, the double frequency NDR laser, diode laser, and the yellow laser. So the argon laser, basically we use the blue-green wavelengths, and this is absorbed very well by both hemoglobin and melanin. And the argon laser, because it's absorbed very well by hemoglobin, you can use it for sealing leaking blood vessels by in various retinal vascular conditions. The main adverse effects are high intraocular scattering and absorption by cataractous lenses. And the argon blue laser gets absorbed by the xanthophyll pigment in the macula. That's why it's no longer used for photocoagulation because of the possible risk of foveal damage. Frequency double NDR laser is a green laser, which is our 532 nanometer laser. It's absorbed well by melanin and hemoglobin and less completely by xanthophyll. And because of that, it has largely replaced blue-green laser for treatment of various retinal conditions. Diode laser 810 nanometer is our red laser, which is also very well absorbed by melanin. And because it is in the near infrared spectrum, this is the invisible light. So it makes it more comfortable to use because of absence of light flashes. This also penetrates very well through cataract and moderate vitreous hemorrhage when compared to other lasers. It's also minimally absorbed by xanthophyll. So it makes it useful for treatment of the fovea. The problem with diode laser is because of its wavelength, it causes deep burns in the RP and the choroid. So diode laser will tend to be a little painful for patients. Yellow laser is a 577 nanometer laser, which causes less scatter. It causes lesser scatter. It has excellent penetration to cataracts. The absorption by xanthophylls is low, so it makes it very safe to use near the fovea. And it's highly absorbed by oxyhemoglobin, so it's one of the best lasers to use for treatment of retinal vascular conditions. Now, the modes of laser delivery that we have lasers which are attached to slit lamps, which are attached to the indirect microscope, to the surgical microscope, and we have endo laser. And now we have these newer modalities of laser delivery, which is the Pascal and the Navilas. So as we all know, there are multiple ocular contact lenses which are available for treatment with laser. But what you have to remember is the spot size of the laser burn will not depend just on your spot setting, but it will also depend on the type of lens which is used, and it will also depend on the power and duration. So coming to various conditions where lasers are used in retinal diseases, first and foremost is diabetic retinopathy. So the main two areas where lasers are useful are in the treatment of diabetic macular edema and in PDR. So ETDRS was the first study that basically gave us the definition of CSME and conclusively established the effectiveness of focal and grid photocoagulation in the treatment of DME. And they reported that with this treatment, the risk of moderate visual loss was reduced by 50%. So the original ETDRS protocol required the performing a pre-treatment angiogram. And this pre-treatment angiogram was needed to identify the treatable lesions. Now, treatable lesions in ETDRS was defined as leaking microaneurysms, areas of diffuse retinal leakage, and areas of thickened avascular retina. So where could these laser spots be done? The two places where you couldn't use the laser spots was anything within 500 microns of the fovea and anything around 500 microns from the disc margin. Everywhere else from 500 microns to 3000 microns away from the center of the macula is where you could treat the treatable lesions. So this was the original ETDRS protocol. The main thing to remember is it required visible whitening or darkening of the microaneurysms, spot size of 50 to 200 microns. And when grid treatment was done, it had to be visible burns, which were placed one burn width apart. So how does laser improve help in resolution of macular edema? There is no one mechanism which has been proved, but it has been suggested to be one because of direct occlusion of the microaneurysm, so there is reduced leakage. There's destruction of photoreceptors, so there is reduced oxygen demand. There is oxygen diffusion through the laser scar from the choroid to the inner retina. And because of improved retinal oxygenation, there can be autoregulatory vasoconstriction, which reduces leakage. And the main thing is restoration of the RPE barrier. So what happens is, because of laser, there are certain biochemical processes that come into effect in the RPE. The RP proliferates and closes the gap, which is caused by the laser scar. And this RP is healthy RP. So this RP basically produces cytokines, which antagonizes the effect of anti-VEGF, and it also rescues the blood retinal barrier. But the problem with this laser was there were a lot of adverse effects seen because the laser burn tended to be larger than the original laser spot size. So there was progressive RP and retinal atrophy, and that resulted in it could encroach upon fixation and cause loss of central vision, central scotoma, and decrease color vision. So for that reason, the modified ETDRS protocol was brought about, and this was the protocol that was used in many of the DRCR studies. So the modification here was it was not required to have a visible whitening of the microaneurysm, but a mild gray white burn should be evident beneath the microaneurysm, spot size of 50 microns, and in case of grid treatment, it had to be just barely visible burns, which were placed two burn widths apart. So studies done by the DRCR showed that the modified ETDRS protocol gave similar outcomes to the original ETDRS protocol and with lesser side effects. Now, another protocol that was investigated was the MMG, which is the mild macular grid photocoagulation. Now, the difference here is in mild macular grid photocoagulation, you do not treat the focal aneurysms. You do a grid treatment to both thickened and unthickened retina. So the rationale for treating unthickened retina was, it was proposed that laser would normalize the cellular changes that were happening within the retina caused by diabetes before the development of DME. So there was a study done by the DRCR where they compared modified ETDRS and MMG strategies, and they found that at the end of 12 months, patients who were treated with modified ETDRS, they did better visual acuity wise, and the improvement in retinal thickness was also better. So for years, the retinal laser treatment involved destruction of retinal tissue. So as I had mentioned, there were a lot of adverse effects because of formation of scotomas and secondary CNVM and laser scar enlargement. So there was always a constant search for laser treatment, which would give the benefits of laser but not destroy cells. So that was how the subthreshold micropulse laser was introduced. Now in subthreshold micropulse laser, diffusion of heat to the surrounding tissue is minimized, and thereby scarring is prevented and the neural retina is spared. So what they realized was, to get the benefits of laser, there was no need to destroy the RPE. It was enough to stimulate the RPE. So in subthreshold micropulse laser, minimum laser irradiance needed to raise the temperature of the RPE without exceeding the protein denaturation threshold is used. And so that's how the RPE is protected. And this also leads to the thermal wave which reaches the neural retina, it reaches at temperatures below the protein denaturation threshold, so there is no collateral damage. Now, since the RPE and the neural retina are close together, the laser pulse has to be in a microsecond range and not in the millisecond range, which is our conventional supra-threshold laser range. And for safety reasons, you can't deliver that much energy in a very short enough laser pulse, because that would result in bubble formation and microexplosions in the retina, and there's a risk of hemorrhage. So these side effects can be avoided by using repetitive series of very short pulses with low energy instead of a continuous wave laser pulse. So, as I had mentioned, in conventional photocoagulation, you have a single pulse which will deliver the preset energy to the retina. But in micropulse, this laser what is delivered are chopped laser pulses to the retina. So these pulses basically come in what is called an envelope. So this envelope has an on time and an off time. So on time is when you have your micropulses being administered, and it is the duration of each micropulse, and generally it will be less than the off time. Off time is the time between the micropulses, and off time is important because this is the time when the heat dissipates. The sum of your on and off time gives you the period, and the duty cycle is ratio of this on time with your time period. Now, by default, most of the machines will have a duty cycle of 5%, and the duration of your on time is usually 0.1 millisecond. Micropulse mode is available in green, yellow, and your red wavelengths in most of the commercially available laser machines. So the main advantages of subthreshold micropulse laser is its safety. So you can use it close to the fovea, and the potential to repeat treatment as required. So this was a study which was done in India by Venkatesh et al, where they compared subthreshold micropulse diode laser with double frequency NDR in DME patients. And they reported that the micropulse laser subthreshold did better. It was equally effective in improving visual acuity, contrast sensitivity, and reduction of DME. But what they found was, by using MFERG, that patients who were treated with the micropulse subthreshold laser had a better preservation of physiological functioning of the neural retina with superior central macular sensitivity. Another thing they noted was that, just like the other studies that had reported, patients were treated with the subthreshold micropulse laser, the DME took a slightly longer time when compared to the supra-threshold lasers to decrease. Now, the explanation that was postulated for that was, effective treated area is the area of the laser spot in micropulse subthreshold laser, because there is no thermal diffusion. So more number of spots had to be applied to compensate for this reduced treatment area. And this theory was confirmed by Levinsky et al. In a study done by Levinsky et al., where they divided their diabetic macular edema patients into three groups. Now, the first group was treated with modified ETDRS green laser burns, and these burns were placed two spots.
Not able to hear you.
Not able to hear.
Nancy? Nancy?
Our network suddenly.
We'll call her.
Yeah, I think she'll again rejoin.
What happened, ma?
Network, I think, something.
No, for past maybe 2 minutes. Yeah, please. Yeah, we're not able to see you also. Please connect again. Make it fast.
So I think before she connects, she's connected. We'll again see. Otherwise, I was thinking we can just discuss some points on what she presented till now. I think beautifully presented the initial background of one of the things like hemoglobin getting absorbing. So you must understand that never treat on the heme. So many a times with non-proliferative diabetic retinopathy or vein occlusion, you have many retinal hemorrhages. And if you directly treat, it will absorb heat more. You'll get a more intense burn. So later on, you will see a larger scar. So avoid any of the blood. I think that was one point which I noted down that that is a clinical implication. Treatable lesions, she did mention a couple of them, but even IRMAs are treatable lesions. So when within, so 500 to 3000 microns, all the CNP areas, the thickening and IRMA, all of them you need to treat if you are doing a modified grid. And we started with focal. Initially, we used to do a focal macular laser in diabetic macular edema. But many times what happens, especially you have cluster of these microaneurysms. So if you see a large cluster, rather than treating each one of them and then they all coalesce to form a large scar, better, even if you have not having much diffuse leak, you can probably do a modified grid in those cases. And again, one of the things is try to spare your median raphe, because sometimes that can cause a scotoma, paracentral scotoma. So even if there is a little thickening there and you're doing a modified grid, you tend to avoid that median raphe to some extent.
Or you want to come to room number 7.
Yeah, great, Nicey, back. Can you again share your slide? No problem. By the time I was just trying to add few points. And she very nicely told about the subthreshold and micropulse. In general, you should remember that when a visible burn is there, you make it 3 times that power, it will cause a hemorrhage. You make that power half to 1/4 of that, you will see only those burns on angiograms, but you will not see clinically very well. And you reduce it to 1/10 of that power, that is actually your micropulse type of thing, though the I'm just talking about the power, but more important is that envelope what she told. But that is the point where it's just causing the biological effect, and sometimes on autofluorescence you can see. The other problem why micropulse never picked up is this lack of reaction. So you don't see that there is any burn there. And so before treatment and after treatment, retina looks the same. So that is one. And sometimes in PDR, that became a problem because you are treating the same area again and again, not knowing whether it has been treated or not. Now, because there are some techniques where you paint the whole macula with your yellow laser, people are using it, but somehow I'm not very favorite because I've not seen very great results. And even the studies which are there, they are not very consistent studies. Some of them, they show good results. Some of them, it's not. And the recent study by Shobha Shivprasad group, they have shown in a very good randomized trial that it doesn't work that well. So yes, there are good trials also with it. It has got advantages, but there are practical problems using it. Madam or anybody else has experience about the micropulse? they've been using it, and what's your experience of using MicroPulse?
So I used, yes, I started off using MicroPulse for, you know, these refractive diabetic cases, or I started using them in also cases of some kind of multifocal CSRs, in fact, to initially see whether I could get a, but I very honestly, like you said, I never fancied to it. Because I still, after doing it in diabetic cases also, I would see the patient coming back with the edema, sure, and the results were not consistent with patients. And I somehow believed that, you know, I am not very comfortable kind of doing this. So not a great experience on MicroPulse, the yellow laser, but yes, definitely have done it. Yeah, initially, as you said, it's difficult for people because they don't see a reaction only. So ideally, what we do is we see a visible reaction somewhere far away from the arcade first, and then actually reduce it. You know, so then you know that that is the reaction that you need to maintain in the foveal zone. But yes, a lot of people obviously had this issue that there was no reaction coming, so they would actually increase the reaction. And so yes, I've not got much experience, but yes, I've used it for a few cases, but never fancied to it. I think the regular anti-VEGF and the regular laser work better.
And even the laser, what ETDRS and modified ETDRS tells us, that use a 50 micron. Yeah. Usually in our clinical settings, we never use a 50 micron spot size. It's about 100 microns.
100. Yes, absolutely.
Chance of Bruch's membrane rupture there.
Rupture,
so though these are certain modifications which we have done on a modified ETDRS thing. Yeah. So,
in fact, in PDR, we've now gone to a situation where if it's not a very frank PDR, you still have like a moderate PDR kind of a thing. We're not even doing a full PRP. It's like a targeted PRP on an angio when you know these areas of CNP and all that. So you don't compromise on the patient's night vision and peripheral vision and all that, you know.
Yeah,
so that concept of targeted PRP with anti-VEGF is coming more into, you know, picture now than doing a full blown. Unless it's a frank case with multiple NVEs and total non-perfusion.
Yeah, NICE is back online.
Great. So we discussed DME a bit.
Yeah, I saw that. Initially. I saw that by the time I had to go and bring her to the first floor, to the second floor, to a better Wi-Fi area. So now she's back on track.
Great.
Let's start.
NICE?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay.
So this screen, right?
Yeah. You can go a couple of slides back.
Yeah.
Just go back.
I don't know exactly where I got cut out.
Little back.
Yeah.
Go back a few slides.
Just a minute, sir.
Yeah, you were on this slide, correct?
This is okay. This is okay. After this, probably, yes.
I was going to say?
Yes.
Okay. So, as I said, the main advantages of the subthreshold MicroPulse laser was its safety. It could be easily applied close to the foveal center without a risk of creating scotoma, and the potential for repeat treatment if required. So, there was this study which was done in India by Venkatesh et al., where they compared subthreshold MicroPulse diode laser with double frequency NDR in treatment of patients with diabetic macular edema. So what they reported was that SDM did as well as NDR laser in improving visual acuity, contrast sensitivity, and reduction of DME. But on doing multifocal ERG, they found that the subthreshold MicroPulse laser allowed for better preservation of physiological function of the neural retina with superior central macular sensitivity. So one thing they had also noted, which was also noted in a lot of previous studies, were it took a slightly longer time in the subthreshold MicroPulse group for the edema to decrease. And the explanation postulated was that the effective treated area is the area of the laser spot because there is no thermal diffusion. So more number of spots had to be applied to compensate for this reduced treatment area. And this theory was confirmed by a study which was done by Levinsky et al. So here they divided their DME patients into three groups. Now the first group got the modified ETDRS treatment, which was visible burns which were placed two spot widths apart using green laser. The second group was treated with subthreshold MicroPulse laser. Here you had invisible burns which were placed two burn widths apart. The last group was the same. The only difference was the burns were placed confluently. So they confirmed that the response was significantly enhanced in the third group. So the third group was the group that got the subthreshold MicroPulse laser, confluent burns, invisible burns. So this was called as the low intensity, high density SDM treatment. And the strategy was called painting strategy, because there was confluent applications which stimulated all RP cells involved in the pathologic area. Now, the main problems and challenges of this supra-threshold, sub-threshold micropulse laser is titration, because there are no visible burns and you don't see your burns clinically, nor do you see it on FFA, nor do you see it on autofluorescence or OCT, because there's no damage happening to the retina. So there's always a high risk of under-treatment and treatment failure. Plus, there are not enough published studies to establish fixed parameters. Now, coming to laser in proliferative diabetic retinopathy, it was the DRS and the ETDRS studies which validated the effectiveness of PRP and established the indications and parameters for treatment of PDR several decades ago. And those concepts still hold good today because of their remarkable efficacy. So these were the parameters which were established by the ETDRS protocol for scatter treatment. Now, these laser treatment for PRP can be done in single sitting, or it can be done in single or multiple sittings. Now, multiple sittings basically tend to reduce the discomfort of the patient and also the risk of developing angle closure glaucoma because of peripheral serous detachment of the choroid or the ciliary bodies reduced. But obviously, this can cause delay and inconvenience to the patient. So the DRCR net had done a study where they compared the effect of one sitting versus four sitting of PRP on DME in subjects with severe NPDR or early PDR with good visual acuity and no or mild center macular edema. And they found that there was no clinically meaningful difference on the OCT thickness or on the visual acuity following either one sitting or four sitting of PRP. So these are the complications of PRP, which we are all quite familiar with. Now, as I had mentioned, these are the new laser delivery systems, which are called the pattern scanning laser delivery system. So they allow for multi-spot burn patterns, which can be administered simultaneously with a single application of the foot pedal. So it utilizes a 532 nanometer frequency doubled NDR laser, and each laser burn has a duration of only 20 milliseconds. So because of the short duration, there is less thermal damage, less burn spread, and potentially better patient comfort without compromising on efficacy. In pattern scanning laser, the burns tend to be lighter in intensity and more uniform, and the area of destruction is basically confined to the outer retina, so it spares the inner retina and the choroid. Navilas is a machine which has 532 nanometer laser. Now, in this machine, there is eye tracking technology. You can do your color fundus imaging, fluorescein angiogram, infrared, red-free imaging. Along with that, you also have your laser machine in this. So once the images are acquired, the area that needs to be treated is marked by the physician. And what the system does is it pre-positions the laser beam during treatment while the laser application is controlled by the physician. So this basically allows for improved accuracy of treatment, especially when you're treating focal aneurysms. And a lot of these slit lamp laser difficulties which are encountered are avoided. Lasers in retinal vein occlusion. So it was the Vivo study which basically told us that peripheral scatter treatment developed after the applied after the development of neovascularization could prevent development of further neovascularization and vitreous hemorrhage. And the laser photocoagulation improved visual outcome to a significant degree in eyes with visual acuity reduced macular edema. The CVOS study showed the benefit of scatter photocoagulation in the management of neovascularization for prevention of glaucoma. In ARMD, now initially before the advent of PDT and anti-VEGF, lasers were tried for the treatment of CNVM. So we had the macular photocoagulation study, which evaluated laser treatment for extrafoveal, juxtafoveal, and subfoveal neovascular membranes. What it was found was it was beneficial for well-defined lesions not involving the foveal center or very small lesions involving the foveal center with a component of classic CNV. But there was a high rate of recurrence because of failure to cover the entire lesion. And now in this era of anti-VEGF, lasers are rarely ever used for the treatment of CNVM. PDT was specifically introduced for the treatment of subfoveal CNVM from AMD, and it allows for site-specific vascular occlusion and cellular destruction with minimal damage to adjacent normal structures. So as I mentioned earlier, PDT is based on the mechanism of photochemical laser tissue interaction. So after injection of vertiporfin, which is a photosensitizer, into the bloodstream, vertiporfin selectively accumulates in the abnormal blood vessels in the retina and choroid. So basically, it has been told that these abnormal blood vessels have very high LDL receptors, and vertiporfin tends to be lipophilic. So that is why it selectively accumulates in the abnormal blood vessels. Diode laser is applied to the lesion, which activates the vertiporfin. And what happens next is free radicals are produced. These attack the endothelium of the blood vessels, causing platelet aggregation, thrombosis, and microvascular occlusion. Now, in case of neovascularization, this serves to induce regression of the abnormal blood vessels. So we had the TAP study, the VIP, the WIM study, which basically showed efficacy of PDT in different types of CNVM. But currently, there is very limited role for PDT in the treatment of neovascular AMD, and it can be used as rescue therapy in patients not responding to anti-VEGF monotherapy. Now, what I had mentioned earlier is a very new, exciting therapy which is being tried for dry AMD. So today, now we all know that dry AMD is characterized by mitochondrial dysfunction, oxidative stress, and inflammation within the RPs earlier. Today, what do we tell our patients for dry AMD? We tell them lifestyle changes and the use of vitamin supplements. What has been recently tried is photobiomodulation. Now, photobiomodulation involves targeted use of selected wavelengths of visible tumor in infrared light. And these can be produced by laser or by non-coherent light source like an LED. So what happens is, this is the mitochondrial enzyme cytochrome C oxidase accepts this light, and this enhances the activity of the enzyme. So there is increased ATP production, there is decreased free radical production, and there is reduced oxidative damage. So the LightCycle-1 study was the first double-masked randomized sham control study which investigated photobiomodulation for the treatment of AMD. So they were treated with Lumithera Balida light delivery system, which delivers three distinct wavelengths in the yellow, red, and near infrared spectrum. So what they found was there was a mean increase of 4 letters in BCV and contrast sensitivity in the very first month immediately after the first series of treatments. There was also improvement in drusen volume and thickness. What they advised was this treatment had to be delivered every 4 to 6 months to provide continuous benefits. And the best candidates for the treatment were patients with dry AMD in the early stages of the disease compared to advanced AMD with central atrophy. Now, in central serous retinopathy, we all know that thermal laser photocoagulation has been the traditional method for treating focal RP leaks because it causes thermal sealing of the focal RP leaks and their stimulation of the surrounding RP cells. So today, thermal laser photocoagulation is mainly used in discrete solidity or multiple extrafoveal leaking points with persistent neurosensory detachment. Now, PDT is useful in subfoveal or juxtafoveal leaks. And we know CSR is associated with increased choroidal hyperpermeability. So PDT acts by narrowing of choriocapillaries, choroidal hypoperfusion, and choroidal vascular remodeling. But as we all know, there have been a lot of adverse effects with the use of this conventional PDT. It could cause choriocapillary ischemia, RP atrophy, and CME. For that reason, PDT protocols were modified to bring about the safety-enhanced PDT protocols, where they had tried reduced dose of fertiporfin or reduced fluorovins. And studies have found that both reduced dose and reduced fluorovins give good outcomes and lesser side effects. Subthreshold multiple laser CSR, like I had mentioned, it's safe to use near the fovea. So this can be used in leaks which are juxtafoveal or foveal. And nowadays, there has been considerable use of subthreshold micropulse laser in foveal and subfoveal leaks in the CSR. In CSR. And the plus point is, when compared to PDT, it is definitely considerably less expensive. Now, in IPCV, isolated extrafoveal polyps can be treated with thermal laser photocoagulation. PDT is indicated in subfoveal or juxtafoveal polyps or when there is extension of BVN network subfovally. And we had our Everest and laptop studies which showed the benefit of PDT in achieving polyp closure. Another use of laser in retinal diseases is in hyalodotomy. So subhyaloid or sub-ILM premacular hemorrhage can occur in retinal vascular disorders like diabetic retinopathy, Valsalva, Tursen syndrome, Schwann-Ram. And spontaneous resolution can occur, but usually takes several weeks or months, depending on the thickness and the amount of blood present. So that can cause permanent visual impairment because blood staining over the macula can cause pigmented macular changes, epithelial membrane formation, and toxic damage to the retina because of prolonged contact with hemoglobin and iron. So in hyalodotomy, what we do is we puncture the posterior hyoid face that allows escape of the premacular hemorrhage into the vitreous. So the lasers which have been used for hyalodotomy are argon green, NDARG, which is your 1064 nanometer, which uses the property of photo disruption, and you have your double frequency NDARG, which has also been used. So usually a Goldman fundus contact lens is used to allow focusing of the NDARG aiming beam and laser. Size of hemorrhage less than 3 disc diameters should not be subjected to photodisruptive laser for safety reasons. It's advised to drain from a region at the inferior edge of the subhyaloid hemorrhage with sufficient thickness to protect the underlying retina. Choose a drainage area at a location away from the photo and main blood vessels. And it's always best to start treatment using the least amount of energy and then gradually increase the energy level until an adequate opening becomes visible. So nowadays, even a dual laser posterior hyalodotomy is done. The argon green laser is used to create stretch bonds, and that makes the ILM, the overlying ILM, taut. And then the NDR laser, the 1064 nanometer laser, is used to cause photo disruption in between the argon laser bonds and create the defect. Optic disfit maculopathy, we all know that there has always been a controversy regarding the source of fluid which moves into the optic disfit into the retinal stroma. So laser photocoagulation has also been advised for the same, and the rationale is to basically create chorioretinal, it's basically to create chorioretinal adhesions in order to prevent further movement fluid from the pit into the retinal stroma. So the advice is basically applying confluent 3 to 4 rows of confluent burns temporal to the head muscle. The types of laser that can be used for this are the green laser, red laser, and the argon green laser. We all are very familiar with laser being used as retinopexy for retinal breaks. So it's done surrounding the break, and it basically causes chorioretinal adhesion, laser photocoagulation. Laser is also used in exudative retinal vascular disorders. As I mentioned before, most of these lasers are absorbed very well by hemoglobin, so they can be used to directly close the leaking vessels by thrombosis. So used in post disease, retinal artery macroaneurysms, foveal wraps, etc. Peripheral retinal ischemic retinopathies like vasculitis, FEVR, ROP. So here the laser will reduce the hypoxic demand to the retina and is useful in these conditions. Finally, intraocular tumors. The aim of laser treatment in intraocular tumor is total destruction, or at least reduction of tumor mass. Now, thermocoagulation is basically used to coagulate the lesion, and it will rapidly raise the temperature of the lesion to 65 degrees Celsius. And this has been done with traditional green, yellow, and the dye laser. On the other hand, transmembrane thermotherapy, here low energy is delivered for a very long period of time so that the tumor is slowly heated to 60 to 65 degrees Celsius. So what this does is there is greater penetration of the tumor mass by the laser. So there's greater necrosis in the depths of the tumor compared to thermal laser. And here the diode laser 810 nanometers used for this purpose. Photodynamic therapy has found application in tumors like cholangioma, aeronautic melanoma, metastatic lesions, etc. And PDT generally enables production of laser-like effect in tissues without treatment. So these are various intraocular tumors where laser treatment is used in its management. Now, just a few slides on newer innovations in treatment patterns. There's something which is called as endpoint management. Now, this was a program which was developed for 577 nanometer of the Pascal laser. I won't go too much into details because this also involves titration to create the right power. But this also allows treatment with sub-visible burns with limited thermal damage. And we have the nanopulse laser, which is also a kind of sub-threshold laser modality. The 532 nanometer laser is used to produce 3 nanosecond pulses. So because of the short duration, there is sublethal injury to the targeted RP and it's not destroyed. Thank you.
Okay. Before we go on to the panel discussion, let me compliment NICE for the really a very exhaustive and comprehensive talk on lasers, because lasers is a subject which is not being used now as frequently as before. So that is the reason why the postgraduates are also fumbling during the exams when you ask about lasers. For example, I would say my postgraduate about 5 or 7 years back used to do about 30 to 40 PRPs the entire 1 year. But nowadays they are hardly doing any PRPs. So the number, the frequency of doing the lasers is much, the indications have become less because of various other modalities of treatment which are more beneficial to the patient. So let's move on to the panel now. And anyway, congrats, NICE, for the wonderful talk, though there are some technical hitches there, but I think it was fairly well done and very, very nice, and very, you covered each and every aspect of the lasers. We go on to Dr. Rajiv. Start with Rajiv. Rajiv, what in your opinion, okay, is your opinion regarding the status of lasers as far as the treatment of retinal conditions is concerned, especially diabetic retinopathy, whether whether that will be your still your gold standard, or you will be an anti-VEGF guy, or what's your take on that as far as diabetic retinopathy is concerned?
So for diabetic retinopathy, for macular edema, which is non-center involving, still yes. Laser is the gold standard.
Yes.
We do laser, and as I was giving some of the tips on how to do laser in these cases, but yes. Definitely in non-center involving, it is the first choice. In a center involving edema, who is you have first option of anti-VEGF and he's not responding, you can supplement, and sometimes center involving converts to a non-center involving during the treatment. And that's the time again you can use. But for proliferative retinopathy, still PRP is a gold standard. So okay. As Dr. Sonal was telling that it started like, can we do a limited laser? That concept came that can we do a targeted PRP? And there was a very nice study where they tried doing only the areas which were having capillary non-perfusion, and beyond equator, they started treating it, compared it with a full PRP. And they do demonstrate that the effect is not, both effects are nearly same. However, but important thing is realize that beyond equator, anteriorly it is fully covered, and posteriorly they didn't go till the arcades, but only covered the CNP areas. So that can be used, but laser is still the gold standard, I would say, as far as PDR is concerned.
Okay, what about extra foveal CNVMs? You will do a laser?
Yes, definitely.
What laser you will do?
Yeah, so extra foveal CNVMs, definitely even today. For DR is fine, as I told you, but NVM, use laser. And yes, if diode is there, because it has got a little larger, deeper penetration. Otherwise, you can use even your argon laser. Important is to cover it. But for those juxtafoveal, I am now not doing it. One time we used to do juxtafoveal also, doing laser, but now it is only anti-VEGF. But extrafoveal, definitely. Important is to cover at least one or two rows. It is unlike your, so no gap. It should be totally white, chalky white burn you can put there. So you need to be, the laser has to be done perfectly there.
Yeah. Yeah. Thanks a lot, Rajiv. And we'll go on to Dr. Sonal. Sonal, I want your take on the, NICE's talk, number one. Number two, if you're going to use a PRP for diabetic retinopathy, can you ask the other people? Can you ask the other people to mute? Yeah, Sonal.
Sorry, yes.
First, your opinion on NICE's talk, number one, yes. If you want to add anything, number one. Number two is, if you're going to do a PRP for a diabetic retinopathy, what is the laser of your choice? Whether you will use a multi-spot or a single spot. Yeah, I want your opinion on that.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much. And nicely, very, very, very well put talk. I think, you know, it was not just covering, diabetic retinopathy or vein occlusions. You actually went into optic pits, and you actually went into, you know, all the other areas of retina, which is so beautifully covered. Even one point on that, very, very well put. So I must congratulate you. It takes a lot of efforts to put in a talk, okay? So really, congratulations. Yeah, so PRP, as Dr. Rajiv said, yes, does remain the gold standard in diabetic, proliferative retinopathy. But obviously now with all of us using the multi-spot laser, we are like so comfortable using that laser. So what I preferably do is that I use a multi-spot laser. I use a green laser. And I prefer covering the laser from the arcade up to the equator with a multi-spot. Extreme periphery, sir, I still feel sometimes it's difficult on the slit lamp with a multi-spot. So I probably prefer an indirect delivery, where you have to go in extreme periphery, say you want to cover right up to the aura to in some patients. But as we've all said right now that we are really looking at, I spoke to Dr. Rajiv that we are more into targeted PRP because we're not like really covering large areas and completely, sacrificing the retina for the patient. So I'm very happy with the multi-spot, multi-spot and a slit lamp delivery with a lens.
The multi-spot green laser. Yes. For the benefit of the audience, Sonal, can you tell us what is the type of lens you will use for a PRP and what is the spot size conversion? Yeah.
So we all using, so what we normally do is I use about 50 to 100 micron, that's the spot size. And we normally use, for the central focal laser, we're using still the area centralis. Okay, yes. That's the lens that we normally prefer. And for the vid equator, I use the trans equator, the trans equatorial lens. So that covers the mid equator very, very well.
That is the 165, no?
165, right, sir.
That is the 165.
Yes.
And what is the normal spot size? For the benefit of the postgraduates, many postgraduates are locked on. So,
when I'm closer to the fovea, sir, we normally use about...
No, I'm talking about the peripheral.
Peripheral about 100 to 200, between 100 and 200.
Okay.
Yes. You can cover up with larger spot size when you're actually working, because the bulb with a multi-spot, you're actually more controlled when you're doing a laser.
Yeah. We go on to Supriya. Supriya, because now we are using a lot of yellow laser, we are using the Pascal system. So, what in your opinion, first of all, I want your opinion on IC stock, number one, if you want to add anything. Number two is, what in your opinion is an indication for laser, absolute indication for lasers, as far as the retinal problems are concerned?
Okay, sir. Nicely, wonderful talk. I know how much effort you would have put into it. And as Dr. Sonal said, you've covered every aspect of it, except ROP, I would like to add.
But
it was very well covered. Wonderful talk. And to what Dr. Sonal was saying, high-risk PDR, definitely. Even early PDR, we are doing PRP. And I personally prefer the multi-spot laser. We have the yellow laser with us. And I prefer multi-spot because the entire session is over in just, the entire PRP is over in one session. Patient is more comfortable. They don't have as much pain. And those earlier complications of, you know, choroidal, sometimes serous choroidal detachments or increased CME after PRP, you know, I don't find it that much after a yellow laser. Also, like sometimes in diabetics, as it is, they have some amount of meiosis, senile meiosis. They do have some reading disability. So to add to that, if we do a very dense PRP in them, then sometimes the accommodation paresis does happen and they find it very difficult to read. So I find that much less in the yellow laser as compared to the previous lasers that we used to do. Plus, for the patient to come back for two or three sittings is sometimes quite difficult. So if you can complete it all in just one sitting. Though I have noticed that the fill-in PRPs that we do sometimes may be, you know, more required with the multi-spot laser as compared to the green laser, because the regression of the NVE is beautiful in green laser. Whereas with yellow laser, it takes a little longer and they may need some fill-in sessions also.
Yeah, but exactly the question I want, because in multi-spot laser, when you're using, you are giving less number of spots to the retina when compared to a single spot. Am I right?
So the thing is, when it says 25 spots in one shot, it depends on how well you're...
No, I'm talking about the overall. Overall, how many burns you are you required to give if you want to do a complete PRP?
1,200 to 2,500 burns you need to put.
Yes.
And actually, what you are telling, it does give this many burns, even Pascal and a multi-spot.
Yes.
But yes, what you are telling is absolutely correct. There are a lot of studies which have shown they need more fill-in PRPs.
That's right.
Yeah,
because so, I find, because when I see a patient, because what laser I have done about 10, 15 years back,
they remain stable.
Absolutely, there is no space between the
things. Absolutely.
And all burnt out retina and is all very good. Whereas in when you do the yellow laser, I see a lot of skip areas in between.
Yeah, so
that is the reason why I asked whether it is less number of burns.
The number of burns are same, but yes, the efficacy seems to be a bit low. Actually, we just analyzed and it is coming next week. It will come in scientific reports.
Yeah.
We tried analyzing 10 years follow-up after PRP, because the only study which has looked into is ETDRS long-term. And this was at 20 centers across India. So we had nearly about 700 patients who had 10 years follow-up after a PRP. And in that, even at 10 years, 30% of them had active PDR. That means still they were requiring fill-in PRP. So one must very clearly understand that it's not only... Some of them, they will require treatment again and again. So it's not so, though we saw that only third of them, 30% needed vitrectomy over 10 years, but still the need for laser continues. So it's not, though we say it is one-time treatment, it is not one-time treatment. It's important for...
I also find that the with the Pascal laser, there is a multi-spot, the spot size is much less. I'm not sure whether...
No, that is because probably the expansion, the scar expansion doesn't happen. In our routine laser, because the intensity is more, it expands. So when you see on a follow-up, you'll see a large scar there. But yeah, okay. Because these are more delivered, the power is less, this expansion of the scars are less, you see those discrete burns.
That's why, sir, probably you also feel that you have more skip areas.
Correct.
Because, you know, the scar doesn't really, you know, expand, and there is not a lot of coalescing of all the scars around.
Yeah.
So that's why you feel that there are multiple skip areas. But otherwise, if you treat with multi-spot, well-treated multi-spot also, I think it's equally efficacious. And
I think one more message
I want to know about Rajiv, if you're going to give the same number of burns like the single-spot laser, how come we don't have any complications if we do a single-sitting PRP in a multi-spot? We don't see the coronary detachment, we don't have that inflammation and whatever we used to see. Suppose we do a single sitting PRP on the single spot. We don't see that much here in this. What is the reason for that?
See, one of the things, even the DRCR net, they didn't use a multi-spot. The study which she told about the single session versus multiple session, it was a normal laser. So it also, I agree with you that it causes less. You can complete it. But yes, there are about 25 to 30% who develop serous choroidals. So if you even use a multi-spot but a higher power, it is more with the intensity of your burns. Mm-hmm. So that plays an important role. And the same is true even intraoperatively. When we are doing a vitrectomy, you do a 360-degree laser, you do full complete PRP in one, but you don't get a choroidal or so much inflammation. One of the things I always say is, probably because the fluid is getting, so whatever cytokines, other things are getting liberated, it gets washed away. But there is no definitive answer why they don't develop, but it is more related to the intensity of the burn and the duration of your burn here, because it is a little shorter duration, probably that is not causing the edema.
Okay, so Manoj online? Manoj is there? No.
Yes, sir, I'm there.
Yeah,
your thoughts? Oh,
okay, I want your opinion, Manoj, on NICE's talk and then what exactly is your preferred laser?
I think NICE has given a wonderful, wonderful talk and many congratulations for that. And nothing much to add on. Already all these big stalwarts have given their opinion. But still, my preferred mode of laser will be a green laser, try to you do a single spot PRP as far as possible because as we are from the old school thought, you know, we still believe that single spot PRP still is one of the gold standard for treatment. But definitely multi-spot is here to stay and it has its own role. So that will be my take. But apart from that, NICE has covered everything and I think panel has already covered most of the areas of discussion as well.
Just adding two, three points I wanted to add, which will see one of the thing which has now recently come up is that those who are non-responding macular edemas, is there any sense of doing laser in the periphery? So whatever capillary non-perfusion area, if we laser that, the VEGF will reduce. So there was this thought coming up, and especially in vein occlusions, people were doing this peripheral laser to reduce macular edema. And that is not true. So there was a beautiful study called as Dave study, and that had a randomized two arms and they found that it's not effective. So doing peripheral laser to reduce edema doesn't work at all. So that was one thought she didn't cover. The other one is for vein occlusions. Our usual thing is like whenever you see a NVD, do a PRP. And when it is NVE, you do a sector PRP. That is not true in vein occlusions. So if you, especially in branch vein occlusion. So if you have a BRVO and you have even have a NVD, never do a PRP.
Yeah.
Because your VEGF drive is only from that sector.
Sector.
So do only sector PRP. Never, it's not like if NVD is there, you need to do a come. Don't destroy the normal retina. That is one thought. Laser, as far as dry AMD, we actually, Lekha Gopal, when Dr. LKG was there, she was part of this trial called a CAPT trial, complication age related. So they found that, but they had used a normal laser. So it is detrimental. So they stopped the trial. So I think that was one part. Hyalodotomy, she very rightly explained, sometimes you may not need to do both the things of NDARG and laser. Even with your argon laser, you will create a small scar which eventually will contract and the bleed will come. Only thing is you have to tell very clearly to patient that his vision will drop down. Because the moment the heme comes in the vitreous cavity, the vision will reduce. So definitely tell them. And besides the size of the heme, which she told about 3 disc diameter or more, another thing is look at the thickness of the heme. If it's a thin heme, a layer of heme, never try to disrupt. If only it is a large mold, you try to do it. And Dr. Supriya was telling about this 360 liter causing.
Also, Rajiv, I would like to know whether it should be a fresh heme or it can be a long standing. It cannot be done in a long standing.
Long standing, it will not. So it's a fresh heme, probably about one or 2 weeks should be a good idea. Even the fresh heme, immediately don't do laser. Sometimes just give a time, about a week, you will see that it trickles down. If not, definitely go ahead. And Dr. Supriya told about the loss of accommodation. Actually, I had series which we had published about 7 cases of myopic eyes without any lattices, 360 degree prophylactic laser done. And all of them came with internal ophthalmoplegia. So their pupils were dilated and accommodation had gone. And what we looked into these cases, I looked into timeline, how it recovers back. Because these are normal 6-6 vision and now they have a pupil which is dilated, accommodation is gone. So it takes nearly 3 months to them to recover. And accommodation is last to come back. Your pupil reaction starts, but accommodation takes a couple of times. So that's something which you need to never treat without any, just to strengthen the peripheral retina, never. Because some of the time, myopic eyes, unless you are very sure of those lesions, that's something you need to keep in mind.
Some patients have 360 degree lattice. Those patients, you have to be a little careful.
And there also, if you are doing, do it surrounding the lattices, not do a 360 degree. That is something which will cause problem.
And before we go on to Ramya, Sonal, you have anything to add there?
To Dr. Raman's this thing on myopic, sir, in fact, actually a lot of pigmented lattices today with patients who are educated, we are not even touching with laser.
Absolutely.
We are actually telling them, let's observe them. It's only when there is a very non-pigmented lattice, you see vitreous condensation, you probably think that it's a very thin retinal area. Patient is probably not educated or going to be not in that area or not able to follow up. Yes, probably would go and do a laser around the lattice. But the barrage 360 degrees is completely out of picture. So completely
Absolutely.
Out of picture.
I think that's
Yes. Another thing is, sir, a lot of us also need to understand that when you see a CRVO patient, you know, today we are not going ahead. I mean, if it's a non-ischemic CRVO, we are actually not even considering laser. We are actually only treating with anti-VEGF, with the macular edema, watching the patient over a period of 3 months, and then probably repeating an angio some 3 months later down the line to see if you find areas of non-perfusion, then only treat with laser. Some patients do very, very well with only anti-VEGF treatments also. Probably they would not require, unless they're going into an ischemic kind of a CRVO.
So another, just one thing here, just one thing to add in CRVO. Many times, no, we don't see fresh CRVO. You don't see these new vessels. You just see a little vitreous hemorrhage. And people assume that when there is vitreous hemorrhage, there is some neovascularization that has bled, and they do a laser, which is wrong, because even in a CRVO, there can be just ischemia of the vessel wall, and that can rupture and cause a bleed. So in a fresh CRVO, you will never get an NVE, NVD. So if there you see a lot of hemorrhages and you see a little vitreous hemorrhage, don't treat it like a bleed from an NVE or an NVD. As I told you, when there are retinal hemorrhages, never laser on
never
the,
laser. I think it's a very good message. And we go on to Dr. Ramya, the fifth panelist here. Dr. Ramya, are you online there?
Yes, sir, I'm online.
Ramya. Ramya is did her MS ophthalmology from Balaji Medical College. And while she was doing her MS ophthalmology, she used to work with me in Rajanaike. Okay. The reason why I am telling that was that Ramya used to do a lot of lasers with me at that time. I'm talking about this about 5-7 years back, Ramya.
Yes, sir.
Yes, 7 years back. So then subsequently she finished MS and she did her VR fellowship with us, and she's joined as a consultant now, and she's in charge of ROP. Now I want to ask two questions to you, Ramya. What is the reason for this decrease in the laser treatments over a period of time, which has occurred? In your this thing itself, 7 years back, when you came here, you were doing so many PRPs with me, but nowadays you're hardly doing not many PRPs, number one, lasers for that matter. Number two, is because you're doing a lot of ROP lasers as well, is there anything different you will do? And the indirect ophthalmoscopy laser, what are the do's and don'ts?
Yes, sir. So with the enormous use of anti-VEGF now, and also certain protocols that have been changed, that now only when we see extensive CNP areas with neovascularization, we go in for PRP. Otherwise, we stick to anti-VEGFs for the initial treatment. And the second thing is, it's also proved that with anti-VEGF treatment over a time, with sequential injections, whatever the diabetic retinopathy manifestations have slowly started to reverse itself. So I think with that's the reason why we are doing less and less PRP. And it is also, the second question that you asked was, is if there is any difference between the laser treatment in ROP and retinal vascular treatment with laser in adults.
Yes.
Definitely a difference between the both. First, I would like to say good evening to Sonal ma'am.
Good evening, sir.
And Supriya ma'am and Manoj sir. And going on to the second question. So there is a difference both in the visualization as well as in the anatomical landmarks in treating a baby and in an adult. Because first thing is the laser treatment is the gold standard for treating ROP. And as of now, the anti-VEGF is only a rescue treatment. And secondly, the treatment has to be initiated in a very short window period. We have to initiate the treatment in ROP within 72 hours of diagnosis. It is not a very forgiving disease as we see in an adult. And thirdly, the visualization in a newborn or a baby eye is more steep, and the cornea is a little smaller. So there are a lot of corneal aberrations. So the visualization should be more vertical. And we need to manipulate the eye for each clock hour. And when we use a depressor and a speculum, we also given more intraocular pressure when we depress, and subsequently leading to corneal haziness and inadequacy in visualization. And also when we suddenly leave the depressor, it can cause intraocular hemorrhages in a newborn baby. We need to monitor the systemic parameters subsequently. Should be done only with a neonatologist. And also when we come to the anatomical landmarks, to visualize the anterior part of the retina, unlike an adult, we'll have to depress it very close to the limbus at about 1 mm from the limbus. We cannot go very far, then we will miss the aura. And the appearance of aura is also very subdued because it's more grayish white with just a very light brown border around it. So the appearance of the aura is a little more different. And while giving white, confluent burns from the manifestation of the disease, from the ridge to the aura, without leaving any skip areas, we should also keep it in mind that these confluent burns should not be applied over the ciliary body, because that can also cause hypotomy and cataract. So though we start doing the laser from the ridge, it's better always to mark the area till which we'll have to do, and then continue on with the laser. And as Manoj sir had specified and Supriya ma'am had specified in our earlier talk in ROP, even dilatation of the pupil can be facilitated with laser treatment. When we start initially from the posterior to the anterior, it initializes, it also gives in to dilatation of the pupil. And here I would like to also quote that there is a very recent journal given by Dr. Mangal Dugra sir and along with his teammate, and a journal which has been published in June 2020, IGO journal, where they have done N532 nanometer green laser for about 300 odd eyes, and they have seen very good success rate. So I think it's all, sir. I think I've summarized.
There beautiful. Is beautifully add. Summarized.
You lovely, lovely. Very nice. Very I think no. I just wanted to ask Ramya and others in the panel. You are doing. We are all used to doing slit lamp laser. Now you want to treat the periphery. As Sonal was telling that I would like to treat the periphery with an indirect laser. So what are the things you should modify when you are using the indirect ophthalmoscope for laser? Sonal?
Modification, sir, indirect mode of laser is absolutely, I mean, it's an old standard of the way old way of doing your normal PRP. It's very, in fact, actually, as Dr. Manoj said, if you're from an older school of thought, probably the single spot PRP is something that you've really mastered. And, you know, you're not going to fail over there doing a good PRP at all. I think just
I
now.
I used to do that, Sonal, regularly. Mm. When before I bought the laser, I'm talking about 97. 98, we got the green laser at that time. Wow. When we started Rajanaik Hair. And before that, I used to go to Amar's place, okay? Wow. And he had the diode laser indirect ophthalmoscopy. Wow. And I used to take my patients there and do all my lasers there with the indirect laser. But it is really a much easier method to do it, but in my opinion. But the problem is, you need to keep on focusing on the retina every time.
Absolutely.
It's a very, very, because it's a dynamic thing, you know.
Yes.
Whereas in slit lamp, you can hold the lens here. Yes. Whereas in the 20 diopter, you cannot hold it. So it will be a little moving around. So that is, you need to maintain that spot there. Keep seeing
so that. I think you need good patient cooperation for indirect. Absolutely. Unlike a slit lamp,
And a fabulous fabulous eye hand foot coordination, sir, because if the patient is moving, your foot has to go off the foot switch, you know, because that's so I mean, you're doing extreme periphery, and for all you know, the patient may just come in the center and you're really near the arcade, you know. So then excellent coordination. In fact, actually, sir, when you mastered that thing, now with the multi-spot lasers in the green laser, you have a particular mode where you can actually go on to continuous. Okay, the pulse one, and you actually start firing, and it becomes like a continuous shot that goes on coming. So, if the patient is cooperative and you can manage doing that, then it's extremely fast to do a PRP, extremely fast. But you know what happens is, one thing that I've noticed when you're doing an indirect laser system, we tend to or we want to watch a burn mark, okay, and in the advent of doing so, we actually increase the power too much. Sometimes, especially in patients where we don't see a good burn in myopic eyes, where you actually don't see very good burn. So sometimes you're unnecessarily treating the patient with high power, and which is where, you know, you land up getting these exudative detachments or complications. So that's the reason I think probably we've all gone to multi-spot slit lamp mode, because we know that we don't need to use high power. We are seeing our burns very well. We are more controlled with the patient now. It's like that. And comfort for the patient also is very much.
Yeah,
no,
but
the indirect you know bending
your
down
neck
so
and
long,
everything.
But that's one good thing for people who are like me who are short, sir. That's the advantage, because when your height is short, you don't have that much of a problem. It's only for the tall guys.
So I think indirect is definitely essential, because your post ops and all that, if you want to do a little fill in oil filled, gas filled eyes and all that, then it has to be with an indirect, better viewing.
Yeah, extreme periphery lattices, sir, or a hole in extreme periphery. Sometimes when you want to depress, the indirect is the right way to do it. You'll do a good job around it.
Yeah, Nicey, you want to add anything? You say anything?
I would actually just like to ask Dr. Aravind, sir, in case of myopic patients where there's very poor pigmentation of the fundus. So sometimes when you're doing your laser, you might not even see the burns. So, but the patient will have pain. So that is how during fellowship we used to be like, okay, if the patient has pain, that means the barrage is happening.
No, many times I agree with you, but in these cases, no, it's not a bad idea to divide your session in 2-3. do, rather than trying to cover all the lattices in one session, try to do it in 2-3 sessions. And in one session, see, I agree. See what happens. Another thing, when you depress, that itself acts like an indent. So you have seen when you do laser on the buckle, immediately the reaction will come. So in myopic eyes, if you're, you tend not to do your laser on the slope, but on the indent, you'll definitely see a burn because now you are actually making all the layers very near to each other. So that is like you are creating artificial buckle there.
Yeah.
So make it sure when you are doing the laser, your laser should be unlike in a, like in a ROP, you tend to use both the, when you use a vectus, you use your concave and convex both. Here you are looking at depression, only your convex part. Try to do it on that, you will get the burns.
A good, very nice message. Yeah.
So there's a, I have a question for Dr. Raji. In the recent Retina, actually, 2019, the Godrick group, they've spoken about 3 anti-VEGF injections. And they looked at the background diabetic retinopathy being affected by it. Like sir was saying, they're seeing lesser PRPs now. So they found that the DRSS, the diabetic retinopathy severity score decreases because the number of hemorrhages decrease, microaneurysms decrease. So on the photograph, on the ultra wide field photograph, they're seeing improvement. But when they're doing an ultra wide field angiography, they're not seeing a change in the perfusion area.
Yes.
So what is your take on that, sir?
Yeah, I would not say that it is reduced because of use of anti-VEGF, your PRPs. Because as you rightly said, now you will see they're already, Novartis is getting approval only for diabetic. So mild and moderate, you'll start treating with anti-VEGF in a view that it will reduce the severity level. But definitely, I think it is long. As you rightly said, angiographically, you don't see the perfusion changing. You, only those lesions tend to reduce. So I don't think that your reduction of laser PRP actually is a problem. You need to do it. One of the things is our threshold for surgery has reduced. So a little heme, go ahead doing a surgery rather than trying to. Previously, we used to wait for heme to clear up, do multiple sittings, next 2 weeks later, even today we do it. But many times, no, our threshold there has reduced. And no, your macular lasers have definitely reduced. There is no doubt about it.
Yes.
But PRP should not reduce. Because if PRP reduce, we'll need more of vitreous surgeries. Because
people probably more. These anti-VEGFs
thickened
hyaloids and
thickened
hyaloids, yeah. PRMs and all that.
Your progression of retinopathy, I agree, that can be one of the things.
Yes.
But the studies have not shown very conclusively that, though there, as I told you, Novartis is getting a FDA approval. All of them are getting to be used in earlier stages. But there are few evidences which are also suggesting that perfusion doesn't change at all. So that's something we need to see how we can use it in our early stages of DR.
Right,
yeah.
Right.
On similar lines, what is the role you feel of a targeted PRP? You know, only you do wide field imaging and see the non-perfusion areas and do only targeted PRP.
Yeah, targeted PRP can be tried. But as I told you, targeted PRP, what people have shown effective in a randomized trial is that you not only treat the CNP areas, but treat anterior to equator fully. Now, we don't do that. So if you are half-heartedly following it, that just treat the CNP areas alone, it is not suffice. It will not work. So your number of burns, if you are treating beyond the, till the, from equator onwards, you have actually done a good PRP. Yeah.
Okay. Thanks. Very nice, Rajiv. Sonal, you want to add anything?
No, I think we've really covered, sir, everything. And no, it's a very good talk.
No, I want to, since I think you were there in a discussion, I was not there at that time. I just want to know about the sub-threshold laser. Okay. How many of you have got experience with the sub-threshold laser? And what laser you are using for that? You're using a diode laser or if you have
the yellow sub-threshold laser. Yellow laser.
Yes. Yellow laser.
But
what is the indication for that? Yes.
So, sir, actually, you know, a lot of diabetic cases which are refractory, you know, you're not kind of achieving the recurrent diabetic macular edemas. So you can actually, you know, go through the complete fovea because it's a sub-threshold laser, or in cases of CSR. But as we discussed with Dr. Rajiv, even I am not fancied to that laser, because even after using it in some cases, I have not seen the, you know, there are not convincing results still. Patients do come back with the edema. You still have a patient with CSR where the fluid doesn't go. So I feel, in fact, in a chronic CSR, I'm more of the opinion of doing a low fluence PDT than actually going in for a sub-threshold yellow. I would probably go towards the low fluence PDT, because I feel that works absolutely brilliantly.
Correct.
I think in the Parveen discussed during the pachycoroid spectrum webinar a couple of weeks back, Manoj and Supriya, I think you'll be able to throw some light on that, about the subthreshold yellow laser. Somebody was talking about it for chronic CSR. Yes, no?
So basically, PDT, not all patients would be able to afford it, right? So if you see some amount of choroidal hypopermeability on your ICG or maybe your OCTA also that you would want to treat, then focal lasers, of course, would be your regular laser. But when you see a area of larger choroidal hypopermeability, we've also published some of our work where we've used yellow laser sub-threshold, and it does act well. So, we've had good experience with that.
So it does act well.
It's very conflicting. Some people say it works, some people don't say. But again, poor man choice, I would say Anand Rajendran's method is better. The Arvind people do a TTT.
Yes.
So it's a TTT. So in these cases, he has a big series of TTT in a chronic CSR, where, as you said, poor man cannot afford it. And they have even published it that it works pretty well. So when you know that there is choroidal hyperpermeability and you know that you want to treat that area, rather than treating with, see, I'm not against micropulse. I have also done many, but somehow results are not very,
not convincing.
In my hands, whatever I have ordered, and somehow NICE knows that I don't do it, somebody else will do it. But
also depends, you know, sometimes we go very less. So you can't go, you know, you're not able to gauge it properly. I think in beginners, when we are learning, we want to make it fully invisible. So, you know, we may not give the right amount of, fluence to it, is what I would think.
Correct.
We've had some good results, but it's highly variable. Unlike, actually blanching a microaneurysm and seeing the effect.
Yes.
Yeah.
I think a little more work on it will be
critical. Yeah. Rajiv, coming to TTT, because we were one of the earliest people who started TTT long time back. I think 12, 13 years back when the TTT came into the
CNVM.
CNVM and also IPCVs have used a pretty good number TTT, and it worked well in about maybe 30-40% of the cases. It worked pretty well.
Yeah.
But I was wondering what exactly be the role of TTT today, except for tumors.
Tumors. Only tumors today we use, and as I told you, Anand, like Arvind people, they use it for a chronic CSR where they are not able to do a PDT, low fluence PDT, they still use TTT. We use it only for tumors. So tumors, it is used, and witnessed all these for CNVM, no, because when I joined as a fellow, I was a research fellow with Dr. MPS, and that time he just finished his radiotherapy study. So at one time it was radiotherapy for CNVM.
With Apollo.
Yeah. So we finished that, and then TTT I recruited. So we have gone. So everything works for a small percentage. I've seen beautiful results of TTT where it really worked well. So, you know, all these works in a small group of patients. I agree with you.
Yeah. Okay. Anybody has got experience with Navilas?
No, I have no
experience. What exactly is your take on that?
The advantage of Navilas is your hit rate improves, because what happens now, you are doing focal to microaneurysm.
Yes.
And with your laser, you put you focus it properly, put a hit, just miss the microaneurysm. Then you again do it. So the hit rate is usually about, on an average, they say about 70%, 60 to 70% is a hit rate. So even an experienced ophthalmologist can cause a little larger scotoma.
Yes.
Yeah. And with nevelas, that reduces. So that's the advantage of nevelas, because it is guided laser with your angiogram. But I don't have any experience because we never got it. Jay Chablani has got a lot of experience because they got the machine. He has published some good stuff. We tried using micro perimetry guided laser, because one of the thought which I had is that whenever we do a laser, it creates a scotoma there, absolute scotoma. So if we map all the microperimeter areas and we spare treating the areas which have got a little good sensitivity, don't do laser that. Only those microorganisms which have got a poor sensitivity, you treat that. This was described by one of the Italian persons. So we tried using that. It works well vision-wise, but macular edema doesn't go. So this was at the time when macular edema was still treated with laser. So that was one try which we did, but not with nevelas. Anybody else has experience of nevelas?
Yeah, nevelas. Anybody's got experience?
No, sir.
Anuj?
No, the only thing to add what Jay's experience, like I'm just sharing Jay Chablani's experience as told by Ararad sir. He said the clarity of funder, you know, image what you get on the nevela system is much, much superior than any other laser systems. So that was a very big advantage he was saying. He like, apart from, you know, the hit rate, the you know, there is almost negligible amount of damaging the, you know, normal tissue. So these are only two advantages, but the cost is a very prohibitive factor in that. I think most of us in routine practice cannot afford that.
Yeah, somebody should give it free. Like what they got, LVP got it free. So.
Which is the company which is dealing with that?
It's a nevelas. I don't know. Nevelas only is that is in India. I don't know who are the people.
Company name is
Nevelas. I'm talking about the dealer here.
Dealer. I don't think they have a dealer in India now. So we directly communicated with the Nevelas guys and got it.
Okay.
Yeah.
So.
And if RRN sir recollects, we were the first one in India to use multi-spot laser.
Yes, absolutely true. Absolutely true.
First multi-spot laser was done by me.
Yes.
Very nice. Very nice, Manoj. It's
the first to use the multi-spot.
First to Pascal laser system.
Any other takes, any other take-home messages I want to give, you people to give? Starting from Sonal, one or two maybe take-home messages for the postgraduates and the practicing ophthalmologists as far as the laser. Many ophthalmologists come to me and ask me, sir, whether to buy a laser or to buy a OCT or a fundus camera. So whether to buy a laser at all. So because I think Neil Brisler, in one of the talks, I think he has told that put the laser in the waste paper basket.
And
Manoj were there in Mumbai. I think it happened.
Yes, sir,
I don't know whether Sonal, you were there.
Yes. In fact, you know, sir, in this January only in Singapore, there was a beer meet actually. And I still believe that the European countries have this norm that, you know, they are not really laser people. And, you know, they have this thing of protocol of, you know, even injecting every month an anti-VEGF injection at an average of 6 injections in diabetic patients, because they genuinely just don't want to probably do laser. So yeah. I still feel that for us, the take-home message is that laser is still the gold standard, okay? And it cannot be, there is no second question to it. You have to have a laser. When you are treating proliferative diabetic retinopathy, in our country, you cannot go on injecting a patient. It is not humanly possible for us, and we need to do a good PRP for those patients to stop the disease. Otherwise, as sir said, that we are going to look forward to doing a lot of more vitrectomies by, you know, just only injecting anti-VEGFs. I also would like to tell the, you know, the juniors that it's not necessary that you need a multi-spot laser only. You can have a simple laser machine and do a single spot PRP and do a good focal laser in a non-center involving macular edema, and you will definitely do a good job in most of your patients, especially all your peripheral lattices and everything. It's not necessary to go in for a higher, you know, system of delivery. You can always go to the standard system of delivery and yet do a good job. But we cannot take laser away. And I think, as we have now said, you know, I was the first one in probably Bombay to learn OCT, sir. I think that goes way back in 2001. when Aditya Jodh got the OCT machine. And I think that time it was whether OCT will ever be accepted also or not. But today, I think we live on the OCT. And so, but then if somebody comes and asks me that, can I not have a FFA camera? I would still say that no, it has its equal role to play. You do require angiograms also in patients. So I think we as retinal surgeons, yeah, I would probably say that there's no need to invest in a multi-spot or invest in an Octa today. You can hold there at least, okay, or maybe a Navilas. But at least the basic OCT, a basic FFA and a basic laser machine takes care of most of your medical retina very well.
Yeah, to answer your this thing also, Sonal, is that Appaswamy has come out with really fantastic lasers.
Yes.
They got a nice green laser. They got a multi-spot. And they have got the yellow laser as well. Yes. It's not very costly.
Yes.
And I'm sure with a little bit of training here and there, I'm sure all of you, even general ophthalmologists, can do a fairly good laser.
It's a lot of senior retinal surgeons also today are even using the Appaswamy vitrectomy machine, the Reticare, and they're equally happy with it. Even after
also using
like
the TurboVit.
Exactly. So I think it's like at the end of the day, they say that if you're skilled with your work, I think you can work on any machine. So I think, I know we have the advantage of doing a surgery on a Constellation today, but yes, at least in the medical retina part, we can start with simple machines and do a good job.
Okay. Yeah, I want to ask one question to all the panelists. Of course, I'm going to come to Rajiv Ravan for his final comments. But one question to Sonal before, because I want to ask one, this is a patient scenario, it's a case scenario wherein one eye is lost because of advanced diabetic eye disease. The other eye has got severe NPDR with lot of areas of capillary non-perfusion. And obviously, NPDR, there's no NVE or NVD or anywhere. Would you advise a laser PRP for this patient?
Yes, sir. I would advise a laser PRP for this patient. Definitely. I would definitely advise. But yes, I would not be doing a very dense PRP, dense burn. And probably, as I told, that I would like I have started doing a lot of targeted lasers to all the non-perfusion areas and watch the patient very closely. That's very important. So good follow-up, systemic control, and I would do a PRP. Yes, sir.
Now, is there a role for scatter photocoagulation? What you are meaning is scatter photocoagulation?
So what we now in targeted PRP or targeted laser or scatter laser is that cover all the non-perfusion areas. And as Dr. Rajiv said, that from the equator to the aura, yes, we definitely do a proper good PRP. And we don't go very near the arcade, sir. So at least you're helping the patient with that particular thing.
Okay, Rajiv, your final comments on...
For this case, definitely I would prefer to do a PRP. Only thing is, not only PRP, tell him the importance of a regular follow-up, because we know that many of them will still... So just let him come regularly. Just final two comments. One is more like some experiences. One is way to do laser. Because many a times when people, we have these exams for fellows, and Viva will say, I ask this question, I from where to where you will do laser, what would be the thing? So everybody says differently. And they all say that I have seen this consultant doing like this laser, this. So follow the book. I think important is anybody says their experience, what the book says, how the PRP has to be done, what should be the starting point, where you should end it, from which area to which area. Follow exactly the book. Don't follow what people do it. That's one thing. Second, for ROP, I would just like to give a small incidence. This is when, I think Manoj will remember. So one of the consultant who was, so I had started doing ROP laser a bit early than another consultant. And that laser consultant went with me to do the laser. So went to, I think, Surya Hospital. GG Hospital. We went to do a laser.
GG Hospital.
And usually the same way, I will mark and say that do anterior laser, anterior to this mark. And after 10 minutes, this consultant comes and says that, Rajiv, I did a major error. I told what happened. She said, I'm swelling the retina. So I am smelling the retina. I have burned the retina. It is so severe burn that I can smell the retina. And nobody, no VR surgeon has ever smelled the retina. So I desperately went. And she had actually burned the eyelash. So that and actually that consultant, I will not say her name, today teaches ROP to many people. So, I'm giving an example, like, so sometimes in training phase, I always, whenever meet her, you are the only VR consultant who has smelled the retina.
Go on. Yeah, thanks a lot, Rajiv. Thanks. Rajiv's sense of humor is really amazing. I cannot forget.
My trip from
Trichur, I'm not sure.
Trichur, yes. The whole night on the train.
Yes. And the whole train was bursting in laughter. Yeah. And me and Rajiv were together in that class compartment. Anyway, sure. Supriya, you tell me what is your take-home message and your message to all the ophthalmologists here and the residents, number one, and what you will do with that particular patient.
So with that, I think Sonal and Dr. Raman have already mentioned everything. Start with the single spot, because multi-spot is much easier. Your learning curve with a single spot is much more. And then you start appreciating the retina much more, because you see a lot more lesions and how to focus, how to get a good burn. And doing indirect laser is very important, because that teaches you a lot about the peripheral retina also, how much to indent. You appreciate the lesions better also. So both are equally important. I don't think you can do one without the other. And as far as ROP, of course, you need to do indirect lasers itself. And do neck exercises for that is what I would say before you start doing your ROP, because you're doing 5,000 to 6,000 burns in ROP. So with that, you have to be proficient with your lasers and your indirect ophthalmoscopy skills. For this patient, sir, I would definitely do a PRP. I would just differ from Sonal and not do a scatter PRP or targeted, which I routinely don't do in any patient. I would just do a routine PRP, cover as much of the retina as required, like a traditional PRP. That's the only difference I would do.
So you will do a full PRP. Yeah. Sonal will do a scatter PRP.
Yeah,
Rajiv,
but then sir,
full PRP.
A scatter PRP, sir, if only the patient is going to follow up and come closely to me. Otherwise, if I have a feeling that he's not going to come back and is not a compliant patient, a full PRP. Because you're not going to compromise on the patient. With one eye, you don't want to do that. Definitely.
Yeah. Okay, Manoj, quickly.
Same, sir. Full PRP. Full PRP.
Full PRP. One simple thing, I feel that you have to take a decision. You want to do PRP or not.
Yes.
If you are planning, do a complete job. That's the...
Okay. Suppose the other eye is okay, in the sense that other eye has got just a PDR with a fairly okay vision, you will follow this patient or you will do a PRP still?
No, in that case also it depends more on the follow-up. Like patient is not, like he's coming first time, you see how his sugars are, how his diabetes compliance with his diabetologist is.
No, all that is taken care of.
So if you are feeling he's non-compliant or less compliant, do a PRP still. But if you feel that he will come again, you have to really do a little counseling that, no, we need to see you. If you are sure that you will see him again after 3 months, watch. Then you can watch.
Okay. Manoj, your take-home messages for this webinar?
I think we have covered everything, sir. Most of the panelists have covered everything. Before that, NICE itself herself has covered most of the top points. So, nothing much to add from my side.
Okay. Thank you very much. And Ramya?
So only thing what I wanted to say was, now that I'm slowly beginning in my career to start doing ROP lasers, what I realized is what the consultant teaches you, and everything is quite different when the laser is in your hand and you're doing it. So this is especially for the postgraduates, to be more patient with yourself and to not get agitated and understand and be conscious as to what we are doing stepwise. Like how I've learned from Supriya ma'am and Manoj sir, the visualization comes first and then where we are aiming comes first. So everything, just be patient with yourself and everything will fall into place. That's the only thing, to be conscious and to understand and do a stepwise checklist as to how we are doing it. And laser is something which we just follow.
Yeah.
And which I'm still learning.
Just, sir, one more final message. My first day of fellowship, clinical fellowship, one of the consultants told me to do laser. And he told two things you have to spare. Just be careful. One is fovea. Second is the wire of indirect. Because the wire is...
Yeah, the fiber.
The fiber. Optical. So he told me two things. Don't pull the fovea. Don't pull the wire. Else anywhere in the retina, you can put a burn. So I think that message also, because that's a costly wire. It's always better to put those messages that, you know, how to hang it and it should not be unduly long. Keep those things also in mind. Yeah.
I'm reminded of my posting and fellowship with Dr. C.A., who was an authority on lasers in Shankar Netralaya. And we used to start the lasers. He used to start the lasers at 8 p.m. or 8:30 p.m. and go on till 2 a.m. Okay. About 9-10 PRPs at that time. It was a water-cooled laser. It was the first water-cooled laser from a famous company, Coherent. The Coherent laser, which came from the, it's an argon laser, 514 nanometers. So we used to always make sure that the water is on before you switch on the laser. Many times the guy, the technician will not switch on the water, and the laser will not get switched on. And Dr. C.A. used to get angry, and we used to really have a good time with him. That was the time when I was doing my postgraduate and fellowship in Shankar Netralaya. Nicey, your last word. Before, I want Nicey to tell the postgraduates here, because as a DNP examiner, I find the postgraduates do not know much about the lasers. So what is the wavelength for each of these lasers?
Okay. So as I had mentioned, we don't use the argon blue laser anymore. So the argon green laser, the wavelength is 514 nanometer, 514. And our green laser, what we say green laser, is the double frequency NDR, 532 nanometers. Then you have the yellow laser, which is the 577 nanometer, 577. And lastly, we have the diode laser, which is our red laser, and that's 810 nanometer.
What about the diode laser? You said 810, no?
810 nanometers, sir.
And the PDT laser is 685.
689 nanometer.
689, okay. And yeah. Okay. So are we at the end of the session now?
So just one last thing before we end this session. To all the people who are beginning with the laser, that it is very important to please understand the orientation of the retina when you're looking through a lens. Because when you start working firstly with the indirect or on the focal slit lamp, please see the entire retina, see the arcade, see the center, and then only start with the laser treatment. Or when you're doing an indirect, you know that you have to first see the entire retina, orient yourself, and then start. Because you should not at any point come near the fovea by mistake. So because of the indirect, because of the inverse retina that we see, it's very important for all the youngsters who are starting off with the lasers.
So when we actually put our, like, a focal laser for CSR and all, when you're doing it and you want your point of leakage, we actually, you know, stick it inverted in front of you, so that you just see what you do. Otherwise, to mentally sometimes invert, it becomes difficult.
So orient yourself first. See the retina. Even when you're doing a slit lamp for a focal laser in a diabetic patient, see the retina very well. See everything and then decrease the slit beam and start lasering.
Okay. Do you have something like when you do a PRP, you put something like a temporal C or barricade so that you know exactly where your macula is?
Yes. So what I start doing is I start doing always first the nasal quadrant. Okay. After doing the nasal quadrant, when I start doing the superior and the inferior, I actually first ask the patient to look straight and go around the arcade itself. And once I've covered that, then I know I just have to go into the extreme periphery. So then I'm not going to be near the arcade at all. and then have a small temporal barrier that is created at beyond the macula. So at least you know that you've covered that entire like a semicircle, and then you're going there from there to the periphery.
What I would do is I'll give a good idea for all the beginners. Use the area centralis lens.
Yes.
Okay, if you want to do a PRP, use the area centralis lens and do around the arcade and make sure, and then you go to the periphery. Then you go there, probably you can use a PRP 165 lens. I'll be failing my duty if I don't mention the name of Dr. Babu Rajendran, who was a real authority as far as the lasers in the retina is concerned. And I have learned a lot from him. And in fact, he propagated, popularized the concept of a temporal C for all macular edemas. Three rows temporal to the fovea. And I was doing that regularly for all my PRPs when I was doing lasers long time back. And even now, I think many of you can, Supriya, Ramya, and Naisi, you can see my patients, old patients, with a temporal C pattern with a lot of lasers, three thing wherein you have three rows. I'm not sure whether it was, maybe it is working at that point of time before the advent of the anti-VEGFs. What is your take on that, Rajiv? Final word?
No, what you are telling is correct. That was a time, this was the way the grid used to be done.
Yes.
And then came the modified grid that we never did that C. We were trying to look at thickened area and treating only those. But yes, even I see many of our old patients, it is that C pattern which used to be done. And I agree with you that no, important is all fellows and PG should continue. This is a skill you cannot do without it. No. Absolutely. And now at SN, actually, more people are, I'm sure Naisi knows, more are used to indirect rather than slit lamp. And I always tell, do more slit lamps also, because the advantage of indirect is you can quickly finish it, more quickly they are able to do it. But they should also be much familiar with the slit lamp.
Slit lamp, slit lamp, the orientation, everything is very important.
Yes, yes.
So, okay, we come to the end of this wonderful webinar. I'm sure it has been very beneficial to all the practicing ophthalmologists and the residents, all the participants. I would like to personally thank Dr. Naisi Thomas for the wonderful talk, and also the expert panel, Dr. Rajiv Raman, Dr. Sonal, Dr. Supriya, Dr. Manoj Khatri, Dr. Ramya. All of you, I think, have thrown a lot of light on these lasers, and I'm sure the lasers will not be put in the dustbin. Okay. It is really a fantastic equipment for you to have, and it will give you a nice, 360 degree coverage as far as the ophthalmology practice is concerned. My opinion is that every general ophthalmologist should also have a laser. It is not, they need some training, a short period of training. I'm sure they will all do very well, because there are absolute indications for laser which will stay on forever, just like corona.
Don't say that.
Corona is also going to stay on forever. Anyway, stay safe, stay home, stay healthy. See you again.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Bye.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.
Bye, Sonal. Bye, sir. Thank you.